Now, we will have the second part of our lecture about the cyanide toxicity. Cyanide is a material which is could be exist in gaseous, liquid, and solid form. There is a structure from it which is called hydrogen cyanide, HCN. It is present in the form of a volatile liquid. So, it can be taken by inhalation or ingestion. Condition of bathing by cyanide could be suicidal, as in cases of person who can get captured in spies, especially. This is because cyanides are known to be the fastest poison ever known, and this could occur in about from 2 to 10 minutes, so it is very rapid. Also, bathing by cyanide could be accidental, and this is the most common in the following cases. As during the fumigation of trees and chips, fumigations means using of the volatile form of hydrogen cyanide to be inspired in the large farms or in large ships to get rid from rats in these ships. It is known that after fumigation, these trees or ships must not be entered or used for a period of time until all the effects of the cyanide gets out. But in some times, chips may be used before this time, so workers in the chips inhale the remnant of the hydrogen cyanide and get poisoned. Also, toxicity by acute cyanide toxicity can occur in electroplating and the photography. During this process, there is a chemical reaction between several chemicals, and so the gases of hydrogen cyanide get liberated from this chemical reaction. Another accidental condition during eating plant containing cyanogenic glucoside, which is called amygdalene. It is present mainly in the unripe, the following unripe fruits, as cherry, plum, peaches, maize, and the unripe guava. Eating the seeds that occurs inside these types of fruits leads to liberation of cyanogenic glucoside. These materials in the presence of emulsion enzyme, which is present in the mammalian saliva, can act with amygdalene, leading to liberation of the hydrogen cyanide. There is also another very famous condition of accidental poisoning by cyanide in cases of chemists and laboratory assistants are sometimes overcome by the sudden evolution of hydrogen cyanide. This occurs because of pouring of cyanide solutions into sinks already containing a strong acid residue, so the chemical reaction occurs and the gases of hydrogen cyanide get liberated. Another condition of bathing, homicidal, is rare because it is very rapid. So this may get some suspicious about the manner of this. So it is very rare to use the cyanide to kill another one. It is also in cases of execution of murders. In some states of the United States of America, is done by gas chamber that contains hydrogen cyanide gases. So, these are the conditions of acute cyanide poisoning: suicidal, accidental, homicidal, or execution of murders. There is a very famous story about a person who is called Rasputin. Rasputin his enemies put cyanide salts in his food to get rid of him, but after eating this poisoned food, he didn't affected or died. Which is a very strange condition at this old times. What happened in these conditions of Rasputin? As absorption of cyanides could be by inhalation, percutaneous or ingestion. If the cyanide salts, as sodium or potassium cyanide, are taken by ingestion, they are changed to hydrocyanic acid by the acidity of the stomach. So in Rasputin, who was known to be a heavy chronic alcoholic addict, that leads to atrophy of his gastric mucosa, so his stomach didn't contain any gastric acids. So when which is a condition known as chlorohydra. So when Rasputin had ingested sodium or potassium cyanide, they didn't change into hydrocyanic acid as there is no acidity in the stomach. About the excretion is mainly through the lung. Also as carbon monoxide, it is eliminated unchanged in the lung. What about the mechanism of action of or the mechanism of toxicity? This is a very important question. Cyanide unites with ferric iron of the cytochrome oxidase enzyme, so leading to its paralysis and so inhibition of the paralysis of the cerebral respiration, and this leads to hypoxia or tissue anoxia. This is known as histotoxic anoxia. So arterial blood that carry the oxyhemoglobin passes on the tissue and it changes, as the tissues cannot use the oxygen due to the paralysis of the cytochrome oxidase enzyme, and then returns into the venous blood containing high concentration of oxygen. So it is known as red asphyxia. The respiratory center in the medulla ceases to function because its nerve cell can no longer obtain oxygen, so it is rapidly affected by the generalized hypoxia. So this patient will suffer from due to the anoxia, there will be convulsion and sudden coma. What is called cyanide cry due to laryngeal spasm? When he taken the cyanide by inhalation or ingestion, there will be laryngeal spasm, so the patient gasping to take his breath. It's like this is called cyanide cry. His facies is like gasping for taking his breath. There will be froth at the mouth with a smell of bitter almond, which is a characterized smell. There is also fixed dilated glistening pupil. Fixed dilated pupil, as hypoxia will affect the Edinger Festival nuclei present in the brain, midbrain and the brainstem. That is control the movement of the pupils. So it will be paralyzed, leading to fixed dilatation of the pupil. What about glistening? Glistening is due to increase in oxygen concentration in the blood film that over or covering the cornea. So it will be like glistening cornea. Glistening cornea. Also, the hypoxia will affect all the vital centers present in the brainstem, the vasomotor center, respiratory center. So there will be low blood pressure, rapid weak pulse, subnormal temperature and gasping respiration. due to affection of the vasomotor center, respiratory center, and heat regulating center. There's also sherry red skin. As we said, the venous blood will carry oxyhemoglobin. And this occurs very rapidly due to tissue anoxia after about 2 to 10 minutes. So, clinical picture of acute cyanide toxicity could be caused by 6C. There is sudden coma and convulsion, cyanide cry, characterized smell, glistening cornea, sherry red skin. Again, it will be 6C. You can keep it by this. The clinical picture or the characterized clinical picture of cyanide toxicity can be, you can keep it by this characterized 6C. Coma, convulsion, cyanide, cry, characterized smell, which is but bitter almond smell, glistening cornea, and sherry red skin. And then adding of paralysis of vital centers in the brain stem. Investigation done in cases of acute cyanide toxicity, it will be laboratory investigation. Firstly, specific investigation for determination of the cyanide are rarely of use in emergency management because they cannot be performed rapidly enough to influence the initial treatment. There is no time for investigation to detect the cyanide. Only the investigations that could be done is investigations after the emergency condition to evaluate the patient condition and to detect if there is any effect of hypoxia on the different brain and body organs. Routine investigation in form of electrolytes, arterial blood gases, blood glucose level, venous oxygen saturation. Here we will take the blood sample from the venous blood as it is expected to have high oxygen saturation as the arterial blood sample. And finally, you should do carboxyhemoglobin level if the patient expires the smoke inhalation exposure, as in cases of fires occurring in houses, there will be inhalation of carbon monoxide and cyanide. The cyanide is produced from burning of any materials that containing fibric materials at the covers of the beds and chairs. They contain fibric material. Burning of fibric materials liberating cyanide. So, in case of fire, you must do both cyanide treatment and carboxyhemoglobin level. Now, we will talk about how to treat a case of acute cyanide toxicity. In generally, in severe cases which may be rapid, that is doesn't give any time for the treatment. Unfortunately, in acute cyanide toxicity, in the severe cases, there is very, very minimal time or no time at all for treatment. So treatment must be started on the spot and very quickly. And its main outline of treatment are, firstly, is to further exposure. It's considered to be the main line of treatment. Remove the patient from areas of exposure and be sure that the rescuing personnel should put on proper gas masks before going into the polluted atmosphere. They must take care of themselves and their safety at first before rescuing the victim. Then emergency and supportive measure. APC as usual, maintain airway and assist ventilation if necessary, treatment of coma, suture, and hypotension if they occurred. Then, decontamination. avoid contact with finite containing salt or solution and avoid inhaling vapor from vomits which may give off hydrogen cyanide gases. Then, the line of decontamination will depend on the manner of exposure. If it is by ingestion, so it will be pre-hospital, immediately administer activated charcoal if it is available and the patient is alert. Don't induce vomiting unless the victim is more than 30 minutes from a medical facility and charcoal is not available. But we before in the general toxicology said that activated charcoal has low affinity for cyanide, but it will effectively bind the doses typically ingested of cyanide. This if it is taken by ingestion. In cases of inhalation, you should remove victims from hydrogen cyanide exposure and give supplemental oxygen if available. And if it is by skin exposure, remove and isolate all contaminated clothing and wash affected areas with Copepia soap and water. Antidotes of acute cyanide toxicity are considered the main line of treatment, and it is the only way to save this patient's life. First antidote is nitrite thiosulfate therapy. It is a very important antidote, the most important. It is composed of 3 ampoules of amyl nitrite, ampoule of sodium nitrite, and the ampoule of sodium thiosulfate. They are all put in a specific bag, which is an emergency bag, and it is called cyanide kits. It is called the cyanide kits. How we can use the cyanide? Firstly, we will start about the 3 ampoules of amyl nitrite. They should be breaking the pyrrole of amyl nitrite ampoule in a gauze sponge and put it under the patient nose to be inhaled. It is very effective in treating the laryngeal spasm that occurs after inhalation or ingestion of hydrogen cyanide. You can repeat this every 5 minutes for 15 minutes. So you will do you will break 1 ampoule of amyl nitrite, putting in the gauze bag in front of the patient nose and mouth, waiting for 5 minutes, then break the second ampoule and waiting for 5 minutes, and finally break the third ampoule and waiting for 5 minutes. So you will have 15 minutes. During this 15 minutes, you should start IV line for this patient. You are waiting for the emergency persons. They should arrive within this 15 minutes to induce a IV line, to give the patient sodium nitrite ampoule. It should be given slowly IV. When starting the infusion of sodium nitrite, you will stop putting the gauze that contains amyl nitrite in front of the patient's mouth and nose. Why we should stop amyl nitrite once the sodium nitrite is prepared or started infused? Because nitrites are very strong vasodilators. So we avoid significant hypotension to avoid occurring. If the both are giving together amyl nitrite and sodium nitrite, they may lead to significant hypotension. Then after sodium nitrite is infused, the last step is to give sodium thiosulfate ampoule 15 سي سي concentration 25% IV. After this, we completed giving the patient the nitrite sulfate through antidote. What is the mechanism of action of this nitrite sulfate therapy? Firstly, the first step is by amyl or sodium nitrites are converting oxyhemoglobin to methemoglobin. They induce oxidation of the oxyhemoglobin to methemoglobin. So, methemoglobin is containing the ferric iron, which is characterized for cyanide. So, cyanide will rapidly run to be united with this methemoglobin, forming cyanomethemoglobin. And the cytochrome oxidase enzyme will be set free to start his action again rapidly. Okay, this is the first step of giving sodium or amyl nitrites. In general, nitrites will oxidize the oxyhemoglobin to methemoglobin. This methemoglobin will rapidly united with the cyanide that is attached to the cytochrome oxidase enzyme, lead to formation of cyanomethemoglobin, and cytochrome oxidase enzyme is set free, and this is our goal, to set the cytochrome oxidase enzyme free to start his action rapidly, and the cells of the tissue start to use the oxygen present in the arterial blood. Then, the second step, we give the sodium thiosulfate. As sodium thiosulfate where it's given intravenously to form non-toxic thiocyanate that is excreted in the urine, and the methemoglobin is set free again. Then, the last step, this methemoglobin is will be reduced by vitamin C or methylene blue to return back to oxyhemoglobin. This is the last step of action of this nitrite sulfate therapy. We give the sodium thiosulfate to form non-toxic substance which is called thiocyanate. This thiocyanate is excreted in the urine. And then methemoglobin will be reduced to oxyhemoglobin by giving of antioxidant substance as vitamin C or methylene blue. There is very important point is that the dose of the nitrite must not exceed 10 mg per kilogram. Otherwise, severe methemoglobinemia occurs as methemoglobin is not an oxygen carrier. So, we must take care. The dose of nitrite must be a very minimal dose to avoid two things. The first one, the significant hypotension, as the nitrites are very potent vasodilators. And the second item is the formation of excessive amount of methemoglobin. And methemoglobin is not an oxygen carrier. Now, we have finished the mechanism of action of the nitrite sulfate therapy, which is a very important antidote, and it is the characterized one, the one of choice, especially if it is hydrogen cyanide is taken by inhalation or ingestion, as this is the only antidote that can relieve the laryngeal spasm. The second antidote is cobalt iodate or kilocyanure therapy. It is ampoule of 20 cc giving slowly IV followed by 50% glucose. Its mechanism of action is by the cobalt will chelate cyanide forming cyanocobalamin. Cyanocobalamin is actually vitamin B12 which is excreted in urine. So we give it the glucose 50% to act as a diuretic to eliminate the excessive amount of vitamin B12 or cyanocobalamin in the urine. The last antidote is hydroxycobalamin therapy, which is also given IV and followed by 50% glucose. Its mechanism of action is that hydroxycobalamin unites with cyanide, forming cyanocobalamin, which is also excreted in urine. Cobalt adipate, the previous antidote, is one of the chelators, the type of antidote which is called chelator. So we have three types of antidote: nitrite thiosulfate therapy, cobalt adipate, and hydroxycobalamin. There is a very important note. In victim patient, they usually exposed to both carbon monoxide and cyanide poisoning, as we said. So you shouldn't give the nitrite thiosulfate for the antidote. This type of antidote of cyanide antidote can't be given in this condition because these patients are having carboxyhemoglobin, not oxyhemoglobin. So the steps of actions of nitrite thiosulfate therapy will not start to act, as he can't found oxyhemoglobin to be oxidized into methemoglobin. This is the first cause. Another cause, there would be additional formation of methemoglobin, and it is not an oxygen carrier. So in this condition, if there is the victim have both cyanide and acute carbon monoxide toxicity, we can only give 100% oxygen by inhalation and hydroxycobalamin or cobalt adipate. So again, never to give nitrite thiosulfate therapy antidote in cases of mixed carbon monoxide and cyanide poisoning due to avoid additional formation of methemoglobin. Here we have finished the main line of treatment of acute cyanide toxicity antidotes. It will be nitrite thiosulfate therapy and cobalt adipate and the hydroxycobalamin. This is the three main lines of the mechanism of action of the cyanide antidotes. Finally, enhancement of inflammation has no role in the treatment of acute cyanide toxicity. We have finished our lecture. We will have two rapid questions. The first one, give reason. Why nitrite thiosulfate therapy is not used in mixed acute carbon monoxide and cyanide toxicity? It is a very important question. The answer will be to avoid additional formation of methemoglobin. Another question. Why she red color of the skin in acute cyanide poisoning? I think it is produced by the oxyhemoglobin in venous blood. As we said, the tissues cannot get or using the oxygen in producing of the energy in the cellular respiration because of the paralysis of cytochrome oxidase enzyme. So the oxygen will remain in the blood and returning in the venous blood in the same form. So venous blood will carrying a high concentration of oxyhemoglobin. The venous blood becomes resemble to the arterial blood, giving the sheery red color of the skin. Thank you, my dear student. We have finished our lecture about noxious gases. These are the references of our lecture. Again, I said that our lecture, which is noxious gases, contains two parts: carbon monoxide toxicity and cyanide toxicity. Thank you again and good luck.